file our heads in order first, shall we? Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we just pray now for a special anointing in your Holy Spirit on Mike as he comes to proclaim the word of truth. Father, I know that he understands the responsibility that you have placed upon him to bring this word to those who you want to hear the message this morning. I pray, Father, that you would bless him. I pray, Father, that as he has prepared and prayed and studied your word, that it would bear fruit for your kingdom here. Lord, I just pray now this morning that the word, which is quick and powerful and sharper than any double-edged sword, that pierces to the dividing of soul and spirit, joints and marrow, and is as a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart, Father, will do everything that you intended to do in the hearts of folks here today. Father, we pray against the enemy who will try and distract people, who will lead them down trails of thought that are contrary to what you want them to hear this morning, Father. I pray that you would fill their hearts with attentive spirits, to take what Mike has prepared, that you have prepared Mike to say. They would place it in their own hearts and change their lives, Father, and those who need to be equipped to serve you will be equipped, and those, Father, who need to change will change the way they think. Father, your word is powerful. It has authority. I pray you will hide Mike behind that word, that he will proclaim only truth, that he would go now and speak what you want him to say. And we thank you, Father, for the privilege we have of being here to so freely be partakers of this heavenly food. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, my prayer will be that everything Steve has asked for will come to fruition. And that is our goal, that is our endeavor every Sunday that we come here. And every Sunday that we come here, we seek to encounter the risen and living Lord Jesus Christ through his word. He has not left us without help. He has not left us without instruction. But he has left us with his word. And as we learned a couple weeks ago, and as I pray we already knew, he also gives us his Holy Spirit to help guide us. Of course, the Holy Spirit using his favorite tool, the sword of the Spirit being the word. So for those of you that are visiting, or for those of you that have just started coming recently, about 6 weeks ago, we started in on this series on the last week of Jesus' earthly life. The last week of Jesus' life was compact. It was concentrated with amazing truths, with amazing teachings, as he almost removed a little bit himself from public ministry to focus on charging and equipping and building up the disciples for the tenuous and very scary days to come following his death. And we know, thank God, through Scripture that his training and his preparation was not in vain. And that, yes, the disciples failed many times, and we are careful not to look down our noses and scoff at them, because we too fall short many days. But we see Christ's preparation for his disciples coming to fruition, where eventually we see them in the book of Acts boldly standing up for the gospel of Jesus Christ. But that last week began with what we celebrate in our church and through churches throughout the world celebrate today, which is called Palm Sunday. That last week began with Jesus' triumphal entry. And 6 weeks ago, we talked about that triumphal entry. And how from the outside, it looks amazing. It looks like, boy, they're getting it. They're understanding who Jesus is. They're saying, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From all accounts, from outside appearances, this looks very exciting. And it's interesting. You can't really conjecture too much from negatives or from things that aren't in Scripture. But you don't see Jesus pumping his fist when he's riding in on the back of a foal of a donkey. humble and lowly. Mostly because he knows the intentions of the heart. He knew that every single one of those people, well, most of them anyways, when they were shouting those claims of who Jesus was, they were shouting these adorations to him, they didn't understand the nature of his kingship. And that's what we talked about 6 weeks ago. So I don't want to belabor the point, but for introduction or for those of you that may be new to us, that's what we talked about with Palm Sunday. It is a joyous day. It is something that we in the church should celebrate because now we, post-resurrection, post-crucifixion, post-ascending of the Holy Spirit of Pentecost, can, I pray, praise Jesus. We can lift up palms and praise and hopefully do so from a right motivation. But the scene that's captured for us in Scripture, the beginning of that last week, is not one that's full of true understanding of his kingship. The nature of his kingship they were hoping for was militarily. They're saying, yes, we finally are going to get freedom from oppression from the Romans, would have been the Jewish mindset. And at the beginning of the celebration of Passover, there would have been many people. We talked about how crowded Jerusalem probably was. There are many people there coming from all walks of life that had various experiences with the Romans. And here they are going, yes, our liberation has come. He's going to liberate us. But he's riding on a donkey. It's not very warlike. He's humble and lowly and gentle. So we see that 6 weeks ago, and as we would celebrate here today, the triumphal entry was when the world met him, but they did not fully understand the nature of his kingship. They did not expect a suffering servant. Very rarely do you draw a crowd by saying, I'm going to have to die, suffer and die for you. Why would I get on that train? I want to get on the train for amazing conquests, amazing accomplishments, militarily, politically, socially, whatever the case may be. Jesus here is saying, ultimately, that is not the nature of my kingdom. My kingdom supersedes that. In fact, those things are cheap substitutes for Jesus' kingdom. So my goal for this Palm Sunday is that we leave here this morning with more heart knowledge on the nature of his kingship and better understand that he had to drink the cup that was meant for you and me. May that cause us great reason to shout out, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who brings salvation because he did have to drink the cup of God's wrath for us. And the text that we're going to look at this morning, if you want to find it in your Bibles, is in John 18. We'll be looking at verses 1 through 11. And this is Jesus preparing for that fateful drink in the Garden of Gethsemane. Now, if you want to follow along, I'll have you stand in honor of the reverence of the Word of God. If you want to, please stand and look at John 18. But what I've prepared for my reading this morning is actually a harmony of the gospel accounts. And what I've prepared is basically all four of the gospel accounts harmonizing the entire Gethsemane scene, including the betrayal of Judas. So while you're following along in the book of John, there'll be spots where you're going, okay, that's where you got that. But there are plenty of other spots where I'll refer to Mark and Luke and Matthew. For the sake of the narrative, I won't interrupt the flow of the story and say, hey, Mark 13, and then this is from Mark, whatever. So if you want a copy of this afterwards, I'll be happy to make copies of you of this harmonized account of this scene. But follow along in John 18 as we hear about this garden scene and the arrest that comes. When Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley, where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. And he said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. And he took with him Peter and James and John and began to be greatly distressed and troubled. And he said to them, my soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch. And going a little further, he fell on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And he withdrew from them about a stone's throw and knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And there appeared to him an angel from heaven strengthening him. And he, being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling to the ground. And he came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter, Simon, are you asleep? Could you not watch 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And again he went away and prayed and sang the same words. He came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to answer him. And he came a third time and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? It is enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand." Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas, having procured a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Seize him." And he came up to Jesus at once and said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and he kissed him. Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you came to do." Then Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him, came forward and said to them, "Whom do you seek?" They answered him, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus said to them, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. And when Jesus said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. So he asked them again, "Whom do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." And Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you seek me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "Of these whom you gave me, I have not lost one." They came up, laid hands on Jesus, and seized him. Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant's ear and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. So Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me? No more of this." And he touched his ear and healed him. "For all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father and he will at once send more than 12 legions of angels? But how then should the scriptures be fulfilled? So it must be so." And Jesus said to them, "Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to capture me? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not seize me. But this is your hour and the power of darkness." Then all the disciples left him and fled. This is the word of the Lord. Father, may we learn from your word and from this striking scene, Lord, what you have for us in 21st century America. Father, may we be your disciples, Lord, who stand upon the rock of the confession that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. He is our Savior. And upon that rock, Lord, you will build your church, and the powers of hell will not overcome it. And we stand firm on that truth. Father, may we be enlightened this morning from your word how we can operate as your disciples today, faithful to our suffering servant, our willing servant, our volunteer victor, who drank the cup of wrath that we justly deserve. May we lift high his name and praise him this morning. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you for standing for that long account. But what I think we see when we are able to hold the entire account of that narrative together as we start to see all of the details that the different observers or secondhand hearers captured for us. And I think what's really cool is the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, really hold together. They share a lot of the same details. I mean, over that whole scene, they probably agree almost 95%. Some of them add the healing of the ear, some of them add and remove different details. What I think that shows us is that there is a variety of perception of a particular scene. Some point to that as proof that the Bible is wrong and you can't trust it. Look, they don't even agree on this major scene in the Garden of Gethsemane. From that I say, no, they've provided different details for their own unique purposes, all of them true. That whole story coheres together as I read it. Nothing in there that by one admitting something and another including it changes the ultimate proof and truth of that story. Just as if you were observing an accident, you know, Paul and Becky, for instance, just to use one that's currently at hand, the driver of the car that was rear-ended has a totally different perception of the accident than the one that was driving, as the one on the right side of the road that saw it and the one on the left side of the road that saw it. And let's just say the driver behind him was distracted. The person on the right side of the car can see the passenger and the driver. And maybe they would say, you know what? There's two people in the car. And they just rear-ended Paul and Becky. We saw it clear as day. And the person on the left side of the road could maybe only see the driver. And they say, the driver was distracted. Well, are any one of them wrong? They're just different details of the same exact story. So this does hold true. If it's in the Bible, it is 100% reliable. Wait, how does it go? All the kids are gone. We can't even get held down by that one. Jan, you got it? Just the last part. Tom's mumbling it. Go ahead, Tom.
Absolutely positive 100%.
There we go. So we hold this story, and I pray that you were able to follow along in John, and you could see where the additions were and where the additional detail is. But John's account, what we're going to look at the rest of our time here, adds much to the scene, and I am very grateful for his details. Because John shows us at least three things that are unique to Jesus' kingship that were totally missed upon his triumphal entry by the worshiping throngs, hoping for a military leader. One of the things that John shows us is that the whole world is arrayed against Jesus at this point. The Romans are coming in. There's the Gentile representative of those that are arrayed against the Lord Jesus Christ. They don't want this man to come into power. In fact, he might start a riot. Boy, if he stirs up the Jews, or if he stirs up the Romans, he might start a riot. And during Passover, the Romans would send a cohort, probably anywhere from 600 to 1,000 soldiers, and they would be at the fortress of Antonia, which is northwest of the temple proper. And so they would be there waiting to help keep peace, because they don't want a riot to come out. Boy, the governor of that region would be looked down upon by Caesar. Are you going to let a riot break out in one of my provinces? So there would have been military presence, not immediately in Jerusalem, but near enough to it, so much so that John records later on that this was a great crowd that came to him. There's some that would speculate 200 to 800 soldiers came out to arrest Jesus. We don't have 100% certainty of that in Scripture, but we know from the book of Acts that the Romans sent about 470 soldiers to protect Paul. So it's not unlikely that they would send hundreds of soldiers to arrest this man. But we also see the chief priests. The chief priests were primarily comprised of Sadducees, another one of the sect of Judaism that would be out against Jesus. And the Pharisees are also mentioned by name. And I think it's also important to note that Judas is mentioned by name. The entire world is arrayed against Jesus. The same world that was singing his praises and waving palm branches just a few days prior. Another point that John adds, another detail that he gives us and that he wants to show us, is that Jesus is in control of this scene. You cannot read these 11 short verses from John 18, 1 to 11, and not see that Jesus is in absolute control of this scene. The soldiers may have come out with their great number. The chief priests were there with their clubs. The Pharisees were there ready to see this man who's troubled them so much be arrested and finally be put away. Now we can get on with our Judaism. But this whole scene, Jesus Christ is entirely in control. Verse 4 tells us, then Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him, came forward. They didn't have to pull him out of the crowd. The disciples weren't huddled around him saying, we got you, Jesus. He came forward. I am he, he says. He's in complete control of this. He is not a victim in this circumstance. He is in absolute, complete control. Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him, came forward and said to them, whom do you seek? They answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. And he said to them, I am he. He's in complete control. Or in verse 8, Jesus answered, I told you that I am he, so if you seek me, let these men go. He's given orders. Who gives the Romans orders? Let these men go. We read at the end, they were allowed to flee. More than likely in fear versus like Jesus said, we can go, we're out of here. We're more than likely running in fear as more than likely we would have been or almost certainly we would have been. But also in verse 11, so Jesus said to Peter, put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me? He knew what awaited him. Yes, Good Friday comes and we're mournful of what had to happen for our salvation. But we're not mourning a victim. He volunteered for this. He was entirely in control of this scene, and I don't want you, and I don't think John wants us to miss that. Ultimately, I think the third thing that John endeavors to show us is that Jesus' resolution and his anguish humanize him and deify him as well, in demonstrating his firm commitment to obey the Father. Some would say because he sweat great drops of blood, that, well, that just proves he's just man. He's just human. Others look at his agony as a sign of weakness. I say no. We've got a God who knows the temptations that we face, who knows exactly what we go through because he suffered them all and more. He's faced temptation from Satan himself, who tries to skew God's word to make Jesus sin, and he didn't. When you walk through your tough times, when you walk through your sufferings, when you walk through your terrible diagnosis, when you walk through the loss of a loved one, when you walk through troubles at work, troubles with family, troubles in culture, troubles in the world, Jesus has walked those roads, and we have it perfectly painted for us here in Scripture. He is the suffering servant who volunteered for this task for you and for me. So let's look at this in a little bit greater detail. Verses 1 and 2. John 18, 1 begins, when Jesus had spoken these words, following up, this is on the heels of the high priestly prayer, where he prayed for you, brothers and sisters of the Lord this morning, he prayed for you. When Jesus had spoken those words, these words, he went out with his disciples across the brook of Kidron, where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Verse 2, now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. This is kind of giving us the setting for this garden scene. And D.A. Carson notes, on the night of the Passover itself, Jewish law required that observing Jews remain within an extended city limit that included Gethsemane but excluded Bethany. So the city limit of Jerusalem was expanded because there were so many people there. So the law determining Jews extended the city limits, which would have included Gethsemane, but they had to stay within those city limits. And so here Jesus is still fulfilling the law. Carson continues, probably this walled olive grove was set aside by some wealthy supporter for the use of Jesus and his disciples. They resorted there sufficiently regularly that Judas knew the place. This particular garden is outside of the city limits. It's away from the crowds. It's a less public place, which, one, suits the arresting cohort pretty well. If they want to avoid a riot, that suits them pretty well. But it also allows Jesus to get away from the crowds. But there's an interesting note that only John gives us. The disciples go out across the brook Kidron. Very rarely is a detail given to us in Scripture for just no reason. And so when I was looking this one up, it was really interesting. The brook Kidron actually would run from almost close proximity to the temple complex down into eventually draining into the Dead Sea. But from the temple complex ran a drain into the brook of Kidron. What, might you ask, comes down that drain? Well, on Passover, there would be somewhere around 200,000 lambs that were slaughtered. That drain would run and probably overflow with the blood of those lambs. That blood of the lambs would then empty into the brook of the Kidron. And Jesus and his disciples walked over that. Whether they had torches, the scriptures don't let us know, but you know they could smell what was in that brook. They would smell blood. They would have on their minds Jesus' words that he's going to have to be sacrificed. He is going to leave them. His hour is coming. And this, the palpability of the blood of the sacrifice was there, rich on their nostrils, if not actually looking at a crimson creek running down through that area. So how did the human story begin in the Bible? Book of Genesis, right? And Adam and Eve were placed where? A garden of sorts. In the Garden of Eden was the beginning of life. In the Garden of Gethsemane is where Jesus wrestled with the ending of his for ours. In the Garden of Eden is where Adam sinned. And in the Garden of Gethsemane is where Jesus overcame sin. It's in the Garden of Eden where Adam and all of humankind fell. And it's in the Garden of Gethsemane where Jesus conquered for all who would trust in him. It's in the Garden of Eden where the necessity for the first blood sacrifice was realized and applied, and maybe even the first drop of spilled blood was ever hitting earthly soil. And it's in the Garden of Gethsemane where the first drops of Jesus' blood fell in anguish. It's in the Garden of Eden where Adam and Eve were expelled, kicked out. And it's in the Garden of Gethsemane where Jesus voluntarily left. Don't think that the garden scene was just a matter of convenience or poetic purposes. Jesus was recapitulating the failures of Adam and Eve and all of us. It's interesting, Gethsemane actually means oil press. Here Jesus is getting squeezed between all aspects of humanity. Verses 3 through 6 then read, "So Judas, having procured a band of soldiers and some officers with the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons." I'm sure they saw the crimson creek. Verse 4, "Then Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him, came forward and said to them, 'Who do you seek?' They answered him, 'Jesus of Nazareth.' And Jesus said to them, 'I am he.'" In fact, literally that translates into the poor grammar of God, "I am." Ego, I, me in Greek, I am. Jesus said to them, "I am." Judas, who betrayed them, was standing with them now at the Lord's Supper scene. He's sitting with the disciples. Now he has aligned himself with the world, who is all arrayed against Jesus. And then verse 6, when Jesus said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. That scene is remarkable to me. One, it's confusing to a certain extent. Like, how did all of these people just fall down? But we have to remember what Jesus just said. "I am." That is a great declaration of the Lord. That's Exodus 3:14 that Jessica was telling us about. That is what the Lord's name is, "I am." Before Abraham was, Jesus says, "I am." The very words, the very breath that breathed this entire world into existence just told the people that were arrayed against him, the entire world, if you will, "I am." And they were blown over. Pastor Kent Hughes says, "Jesus' response was the last exercise of the power by which he calmed the seas, stilled the winds, healed the sick. In a very real sense, the cohort did not arrest Jesus, he arrested them." Hughes continues, "His words were a gracious warning that they were in way over their heads." I love that. Christ could have called 10,000 angels, each 60 feet high, armed with laser beams, but he did not. And then Hughes poignantly asks, "I wonder what was in Judas's mind as he struggled back to his feet." They were in way over their heads. Jesus is not a victim here. He could have called down legions of angels, or merely said, "Die," and they would have. But he said, "I am." It's a gracious warning. You're in over your head. I am the God of the universe. Fall on your knees and worship me. Don't fall on your backside, but fall forward on your face before me. Become prostrate before me and beg me for forgiveness, for new life. My hope is that in heaven we may meet some of those cohort who later on maybe said, "Wow, that was the Son of the living God." And you know what? When Jesus sees them, if they had any of them happen to be saved, you know what he says to them when he sees them? He says, "I can't believe what you did to me." Right? Oh. He says, "Well done, good and faithful servant." That's the nature of his kingship. In the face of Jesus' self-declaration of deity, of his being divine, of him saying, "I am," the power of life and death, the power that breathed the world into existence, knocked them off their feet and back in reverential awe. And it is a gracious warning that they were in way over their heads. It was not by military might that he would free the world from sin, and the military or the Jewish establishment and even Jesus' own betrayers were all knocked backwards onto their backsides. Verses 7 through 11, as they scrambled back to their feet, as Judas gets back to his feet. Verse 7. "So he asked them again, 'Whom do you seek?' And they said, 'Jesus of Nazareth.' Jesus answered, 'I told you that I am he. So if you seek me, let these men go.' This was spoken to fulfill the words that he had spoken of those whom you gave me, Father. I have not lost one. Verse 10, then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's servant, and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. So Jesus said to Peter, put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me? It was with great gravity and seriousness that Jesus approached the cross. This entire scene shows us that Jesus knew what awaited him. And not only did he pray for you in John 17, but he knows you by name. And he knew you by name in the garden. When he was preparing to suffer, he didn't say, I'm saving those people, some group of people in the future. He knew you by name. That's your God. That to me is remarkable. He knew that he was going to have to drink the cup that the Father has given him. And so now we ask, now what? What are we to do? How are we to respond to what Jesus has done for you? Not just for the church, as we impersonalize it. Not just for Christians, not just for believers, or not just those who follow him or walk like him. No, for you. Now what? I think there's a couple ways we can look at this. And the first way I want to look at it is the horizontal response. For the unsaved, how do you respond to this? Well, I would say with a broken and a contrite heart. Knowing that your God is not coming to rule militarily, not coming to create a theocracy, if you will. But when he does make all things new, there's going to be two kingdoms of his. There's going to be one heaven on earth, glorious, face-to-face fellowship and communion with the risen Lamb, the slain Lamb who now stands, and those that are separated from his love. Those that will spend an eternity in hell. And we don't say that lightly. So if you have not contended with your own sinful state before the perfect and holy God, how do you respond to the scene? You respond to the scene by falling on your knees in a broken and contrite heart and saying, yes, Lord, forgive me, I am a sinner. I want to repent from those sins because I see a God who has saved me. I see a God who didn't ask me to clean myself up before I could come to him. I see a God who says, just bring your junk with you. Get up off your backside and bring your junk with you. I will work with you, personally, individually. I will send my Holy Spirit to you to work with you. Fall on your knees. What more could we do than just say, God, I have nothing to offer you. Take my agreement that I am a sinner. God promises that when we call upon him, he forgives us and he cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Something no other ill-conceived God could ever do. All of them require something of you before you can consider yourself saved. All of them, every single one of them say, bring me something, do something for me. Jesus says, come as you are. Bring your junk, get up off your backside, just knock on your backside, get up and come as you are. Don't go to the pool and clean. Don't go to the shelter and serve and think that that's going to make you acceptable to me. No, you're acceptable to me when you agree that you are a sinner and you need my forgiveness. That's one of the ways we can respond horizontally. Actually, is that horizontally? That's vertically. It's terrible geometry or geography. Or is that physics? For the saved, what is your response? I would say it's a heart of thanksgiving, gratitude, devotion, love, maybe even awestruck wonder. In the face of the ongoing enslavement to sin, in the face of fear, he offers you release. And when you fall back into that again, he offers you release and relief. In the face of anxiety of what's to come in the future, any one of the situations that you can conjure up in your mind, he offers you peace. Are you walking in the valley of the shadow of death from the loss of a loved one? offers you comfort. Do you have that terrible diagnosis where your future is uncertain? He offers you home. Now, how about our horizontal response? I would say that we are to love one another boldly, sacrificially, as Christ has loved us. I would say we're to hold each other accountable. The eager, fleshly response of Peter is not always the right answer. Gotcha, Malchus. One year. 1,299 more years I got to cut off. But I caught one. We're to hold each other accountable. Jesus demonstrates that for us. He says, no, it's not by the power of the sword that my kingdom is going to reign and rule. It's through ruling in your heart, changing your motivations, holding each other accountable. How many times did he have to say to Peter, well, he warns him that he's going to deny him. He also says to Peter, get behind me, Satan. There's a strong rebuke. But say we all start to watch out for one another. We're supposed to love one another, to be a safety net for one another. When we are hurting, when we are struggling, make sure we're not going through it alone. The body of Christ doesn't hold together when it's disconnected. Hey, finger way over there, good luck. No, it's connected to the hand, which is connected to the arm, which is connected to the body. We hold up one another, we serve one another, we love one another, we're a safety net for one another so that we don't let each other fall. It's a testimony against the church when we let that happen, against the body of Christ and his testimony to the world when we let that happen. I would say horizontally, we're also to not look for or find our security in worldly means. In political power, or even in Supreme Court justices, as positive as those things are, especially when we see them upholding the values of God, but as quickly as they're voted in, they can die or be eliminated some other way. Because if we ride the tide of political popularity or military might, we will eventually be disappointed. But if you put your hope in the God who has already been victorious, who sits on the throne as a slain lamb risen, you will not be disappointed. No, it doesn't mean your life will be perfect. No, it doesn't mean you won't have troubles and trials in your life. But it means when you do, you can grab onto the throne, which is the rock of your salvation, that does not get shaken by storms or winds or any earthquakes. Stand on the firm throne of Jesus Christ. Don't find your security anywhere else. When I think about our youth, they're in a very difficult spot, especially in culture today. They're bombarded through every means possible. Social media, the television shows they watch, the movies that are marketed towards them, with messages against what the Bible says about who God is and what he demands of us. I want to encourage our youth this morning to stand firm, that when everyone in the lunchroom is laughing at you for bowing your head in prayer, God says, well done. When your friends say, are you going to talk about the Bible or Jesus again? Stand strong, stand firm. It's not their approval that you seek, as hard as that is going to be. You are walking in a minefield where people are calling and trying to pull you away from who Christ is. And it only gets worse as you move into the college ranks. So many of our colleges are designed almost intentionally to pull you away from who God is. The Bible isn't true. This shows that the God of the Bible isn't true. Stand firm on the Word of God. In fact, I pray for you almost most often. So many of us get involved in our adult lives and we can insulate ourselves from so many of those things. We're less social. We have a smaller social circle. And we can almost pick and choose, but when you're in school, you can't. You're confronted with it daily. Be strong. If you're a parent of those age kids, encourage them. If you know those kids, if they just come here, if you see them in the public, encourage them. And it doesn't even mean things are easy for adults either. We face it as well. And so I think what Jesus has for us here is he's calling us to see the nature of his kingdom, the nature of his kingship. It's not through military might and power. It's far greater than that. With the speaking of I am, he knocked down an army. He had all the power militarily that he needed. It's the power over sin and death and Satan, which can condemn you to hell if you go there unforgiven by God. So as we wrap up our time this morning, that's what I want to leave you with, an encouragement. If you're not sure you're saved, if you feel comfortable, come talk to me, come talk to a follower of Christ that you may trust. It doesn't even have to be that, though, because that transaction happens between you and God alone. And your loving Savior, who in the Garden of Gethsemane sweat great drops of blood for you, began his time, began his passion, began his time in captivity in the world system to give you freedom. Freedom from the fear of death and what that brings. Freedom from the world's condemnation. Freedom from sin. Sin that so easily ensnares and enslaves. And he calls you to new life. New life in Christ. He gives you the Holy Spirit to help you accomplish it. There's not a greater offer out there. And why? Because it's true. Let's pray. Victorious God, Lord, we thank you that in this scene, as John captured it, Lord, we see Jesus volunteering and not a victim. Lord, we see him standing victorious and not defeated. Father, we see him with the power of his words able to control an army. And yet, he knew that he would have to drink the cup of your wrath that we deserved. And Father, he did so with his children in mind. Naming the stars was nothing for him. Placing the stars was nothing for him. But Father, he thought with gravity and seriousness about what he had to do to save his children. And Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for a God who loves us, who sacrifices for us, and who builds us up day by day in the grace of your word by the power of the Holy Spirit. And it's in Christ's precious name we pray. Amen.